Consumers today are different to that of the past. They have different expectations, different values, and subsequently different expectations of the brands they engage with. And so if companies want to connect with current and future consumers, they need to do things a bit differently. My name is Holly Schaaf. Today, I have the pleasure of sitting down in the host seat again. And joining us is Ashley Fell, our Future Report host and Director of Advisory at McCrindle, to discuss the future consumer. So welcome back to the podcast, Ash.
Thank you so much, Hol.
It's great to have you on as the guest again, and the host usually, so you get to hear a bit more of your insights today. And the future consumer is a topic that you, among our advisors, go out and speak on super frequently, which is great. Even me, in being one who takes a lot of the briefs from clients and helps, you know, curate those solutions for events, whether that's a keynote or a workshop or a strategy session, across all of the content that we speak on here at McCrindle, the insights that we release. The future consumer is definitely one that is front of mind for so many organizations looking to have their finger on the pulse of this specific area and trend. So it's great to be able to chat about that more with you today, Ash, as a futurist and social researcher yourself. And so you, as I mentioned, are asked regularly to present on this topic. But what sort of organizations are you finding take a keen interest on this topic?
It seems like anyone and everyone, to be honest. And I would say, as you would know as well, that at least like 40 of the, you know, 200 engagements we have done, however many it is, there's so many that we've delivered this year so far. And yeah, so many of them are asking about consumer behavior and consumer insights. So lots of different companies. I feel like it's almost anyone that engages people, and whether that's sort of a B2C, which is sort of, you know, not slang. It's an acronym for business to consumer, or even B2B, business to business, their customers, whether they're other businesses or they're sort of direct to consumer. So I remember speaking to lots of banks about this topic this year. I've spoken to sort of smaller organizations, property developers, charities, consumer facing companies, even schools have consumers. And sometimes when schools talk to us, they will talk about how their students are consumers, but also their parents are kind of the key decision-making consumers. So they have a few different sort of stakeholders, is maybe another way to talk about consumers. I've spoken to aged care institutions, law firms, so lots of different industries, lots of different sectors and associations. And I feel like it's really everyone and anyone who has products to sell or market is taking quite an interest in this topic.
Yeah, absolutely. And I totally resonate with that, in the sense that of all the organizations that I have the opportunity to work with on these briefs, like I mentioned before, I definitely think it is a broad scope of ones looking at this topic and wanting to integrate these insights into their decision making in terms of looking into the future and helping, you know, strategically plan their marketing, whether that is, or their product development, all of those sort of things, because the future consumer does impact so much and so many of these different areas of business. So I totally agree on that front. But I guess broadly speaking, just diving right into the insights here, how have you seen consumer habits change over time?
Yeah, it's been an interesting sort of evolution of technologies and ways of sourcing information and going to trusted sources, and how those trusted sources have changed over time, that I think has really resulted in consumer habits changing. And people who are fans of McCrindle, or have been for a while, will know that we love to produce infographic sort of resources. Yeah. And for anyone watching a video of this podcast on a snippet on social media or on YouTube, you can maybe see me holding up one of our most recent infographic summaries, which is about Gen Z. But this kind of generations table device resource, not device, resource that we have developed over time has been one of our most accessible sort of resources. And it looks at every generation, from the builders right through to Generation Alpha, and the different social markers, the iconic cars and iconic toys and music devices. And the music one's really even fun, because you look at, you know, the record player for the builders, through to the audio cassette for the boomers, to the Walkman for Gen X, iPod for Gen Y, Spotify for Gen Z, and now smart speakers for Alpha. So it kind of looks at different emerging technologies. But something else that we did in one of these infographics was we looked at marketing, learning styles, ideal leaders, and using kind of that as a bit of a premise, what we are in the process of developing at the moment and will be released in the coming weeks will be like a future consumer infographic kind of table that looks at every sort of generation and the value they hold as consumers, their marketing channels that they've kind of grown up with. So if we think about the baby boomers, our older generations, they were growing up and engaging and are used to engaging with mass media and print and TV and radio. So if you're a consumer insights executive a few decades ago, you're thinking, how do we make a traditional advertising campaign on the television or on a billboard, you know, over the highway? And then we've moved for Gen X to kind of this rise in online media. Gen Y saw the real rise of social media. Gen Z have really engaged in short form content. And Gen Alpha today and into the future, we think will engage with AI algorithm suggestions. So even thinking about those marketing channels, how they've changed over time, I think then also has an impact on the customer service preference, from in-person preferences among older generations through to the evolution of call centers and email and live chat. And in the future, we might see more virtual bots or AI answering questions like ChatGPT even, and being able to give quite a personalized level of customer service. So all these things play into consumer behavior, even payment methods, moving from cash and checks in the older sort of days of the baby boomers through to direct debit and then PayPal and debit cards. Mm-hmm. And now we're in an era of contactless and virtual payments, digital wallets, crypto. So you can see, I think, what's permeating a lot of this is the rise of the digital and digital payments, younger people not carrying cash anymore. It really has, I guess, led to then an evolution of some behaviors, even the values that consumers have from sort of higher brand loyalty among older generations. And that was quite relevant and important in the past, through to sort of purpose-driven, prioritizing ethics over loyalty consumers of today, and even more of a focus, I think, in the future we'll see on brand transparency and focus on authenticity. And
absolutely,
I think when we talk about consumers in these sorts of presentations, we talk about them as being digital. We talk about them as being social as well. And you might recall, you know, running or filling in a survey whenever you've the key example I have, partly because I worked at a gym when I was at university and studying, and I remember when people would try and like quit the gym, I would, as the duty manager on shift, have to like go through with them and kind of fill in like a little paper survey and be like, oh, why are you quitting, and trying not to like guilt trip anyone into like a decision about quitting the gym. But it's like, why are you quitting? It's like, how did you hear about us? Like all these questions. And oftentimes it is that kind of, how did you hear about us? And it's word of mouth, or it's digital advertising. And it's interesting even to see how those options in a survey like that have evolved over time. And what I wanted to, the point I'm trying to make here is this, the power of the social, and that consumers are social, and we've moved probably away from that focus on word of mouth when you literally speak to someone at a dinner party about something, through to today, online recommendations and the power of recommendations, the proof about a brand or a product or a company is in what others say about the brand, more so than what the brand says about itself. Yeah. And so we've seen that in some research as well, where younger generations particularly are saying, yeah, we do value the recommendation of friends, family, even social media influencers. And so there's that kind of social aspect of marketing and consumer habits. And the final one I wanted to touch on is just that consumers today are so visual, and they really are expecting marketing and the way they consume content to be displayed in interesting ways. Mm-hmm. And I think about that even, and you and I sometimes will show each other, you know, through our group messages, and sometimes it's work related, sometimes it's not, particular influencer marketing that's quite effective. Yeah. And especially online today, there's this group of, there's so many TikTok influencers, or, you know, Instagram influencers. One that's quite interesting to the corporate world is a girl named Corporate Natalie. And I've just seen, it's worth having a look if you're a brand or a marketer, because her marketing today is so creative. It's so subtle. And sometimes, and I see in the comments that I'm watching a video and I'm like, this is an ad. And I didn't realize. And because we're getting so creative and sassy, and, you know, whereas I think of the past, you had to, if you were a brand, you were able to command the attention of the audience because I don't know if you're old enough to remember, Holly, but free to air TV, and you'd have to sit there through the ads, and that would be your bathroom break or fill up the popcorn or whatever it might be. Whereas today, we don't have that with streaming platforms and paying subscriptions. So to get people's attention, I think brands have had to just become so much more creative, and people today are visual. And the other quote I often share in presentations about consumers and marketing is one from Seth Godin, who said, marketing is no longer about the stuff that you make, but about the stories that you tell. Mm. And so your brand or your product is only really as good as how you can market it. And I think keeping in mind that consumer habits have changed over time to become more digital, more social, and more visual. So yeah, there's some of the ways I think consumers have sort of evolved.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Great insights there, Ash. And it's so interesting even for myself to reflect on so much of what you're saying, because as a Gen Z consumer myself, there's so much of what you're talking about that I resonate with on a deep level in terms of my everyday engagement, even with what you highlighted there in terms of authenticity with whether that is influencers or brands or whatever it might be. I definitely find, and maybe there is a certain element of it as well, that with the younger generations, with having, you know, different mediums for marketing and ads and coming through they don't want the influencers to kind of be almost not subtly kind of marketing a product or whatever it might be, this brand deal that they have. They see that as being inauthentic, so automatically will not choose to engage with that product because it's like, oh, clearly you're being paid. You don't really care about this thing. It's to get your own money. You're trying to influence me on something that maybe you don't even want to buy. Whereas mm-hmm. I find, even with myself, like I said, as a Gen Z consumer myself, the most effective consumer marketing to be when I'm on TikTok and I see even some of my friends who have brand deals and do these things online, and they're just talking about how they integrate it into their daily life. And whether that's sure or not, I'm not sure, but they do a great job of telling a story of their day and how this product actually elevates their day or makes their life easier with this sort of thing. And you can tell it's more subtle and it comes across a lot more authentic. And I find that people within my generation, these younger generations, definitely seem to be engaging with that sort a lot more. But it's fascinating to see how that's changed over time. And I guess kind of in light of that as well, what do you see today that consumers value as well?
Yeah, it's a really, really good question, a really important one. And we have conducted a couple of surveys over the last sort of 12 to 18 months that I often draw on when I am talking about this in a presentation. The first is a survey of Australians, and we ask this question: how important are the following to you in the buying experience? And we tested a bunch of different things. And I will preface this by saying that the narrative that I feel as though we were sort of sharing about over the last few years is talking about how younger generations are ethically driven, and there's so much more that goes into the consumer purchasing sort of decision today. It's not just what does this cost. But having said that, what I think has been interesting to observe over the last couple of years is, in light of the cost of living sort of crisis and economic conditions that we're in, and rising cost of living and inflation, which has just permeated so much of the public discourse and conversation of the last 3 to 4 years, I think we have seen price become increasingly kind of important again. And this was reflected mm-hmm. in this study. So when we said how important are the following to you in the buying experience, 85% of people said price is extremely or very important to them. And that was the number one response. Yeah. That was followed by 65% who said simplicity of purchase, and 61% who said authenticity of the brand. So those two came in at a pretty close sort of second, and then second and third. Fourth was brand values align with me at 41%, and another 41% also said environmental credentials of the brand or product. So you've got a mix of things going on here. So price kind of is the most important, like bottom sort of base level, like what's the price? What do I have to give for this product? But I think what I also draw attention to from these insights is, I think what's really interesting is the simplicity of the purchase is really, really important. And the example I give when I give these talks is, I say, picture yourself and you're like in a consumer situation. You have made a decision that you've been influenced, however it might be, whether it's radio advertisement, TV advertisement, subtle influencer on TikTok, whatever, whoever it was. Day in the life, they shared a product. I listened to a podcast yesterday. They were talking about this perfume. I went and bought one. Like, I was influenced.
The Michael Bublé.
Yes.
I know exactly what podcast you're thinking about. And I was actually going to go to Chemist Warehouse this afternoon to smell that perfume because I heard it on the podcast. Yep. So there you go. Perfect example of how effective it is.
Yep. I was at the shop yesterday afternoon. I had the afternoon off and I was like, oh, I'm just going to go see it. And the thing was, like, I trust I'm influenced. Clearly I am influenced. Consider me influenced by this podcast. And shout out to any of the people who know what podcast that is. And
if you know, you know.
If you know, you know. And I think exactly what we're talking about here, they were like, oh, it's only $29.99. I was like, for a perfume, done. Like, that is affordable in the cost of living environment. So for me as a consumer, I was like, it's price. There's a Chemist Warehouse near me. It was convenient. And so there is that simplicity. So the example is, you know, wherever you've seen it and you go to buy something, if it's too hard, if you can't find the product, especially in an online environment, and I feel like most brands and organizations have made this clear now and easy, but I feel like there was a time when online platforms were still emerging or websites, and if you couldn't find like the buy now, click here button in the first like 2 minutes, you'd be like, oh, it's too hard. It's in the too hard basket.
Yeah.
And now it's like, if you can't find it in the first 30 seconds, it's in the too hard basket. People will go somewhere else. People will, because I think as consumers, our expectations are so high these days because of technology and digital devices where everything is like fed to us on a platter. Your Spotify Wrapped, your the AI for Netflix, like it's all delivered to you. It's all personalized to you. It's customized. And so as consumers, our expectations are really high. So I think in the past, we would have older generations who would probably exhibit a lot more patience and would spend a good 10 minutes, you know, working out how to buy something. Whereas today, and I think the lower the price point is probably more relevant because you might be doing a one-click purchase online. You're like, I just want to buy this. I just want to get tick this off my list. I'm busy. I'm time poor. Or we perceive that we're time poor. And so we want things to be simple. So I think that's a key thing I would say for brands and consumers. It's like at the base level these days is if it's not simple, if it's too hard, people will not buy from you. So that's, I think, a really important part, especially for younger generations. Yeah. So that's, I think, the values that people have. But the other study I want to reference is we asked a very similar question, but it was a bit more pointed towards high value purchases. So we said, how likely are you to do the following when making a significant purchase? And the top response was that people will shop around so they know they have found the best deal. So again, sort of linking to the price of things in this kind of context. But the second one, so that was 71% of people said shop around so they know they found the best deal. The second response was 68% who said they will shop at brands that they know and that they trust. And so the aspect of trust here is also really key. If you're buying from like a new brand, I think there's higher risk. So people are kind of investigating it a bit more. So that was the two overwhelming top responses. But then what we kind of got into in this question was the power of recommendations. And so we were seeing that 56% of people were going to look up reviews to understand other people's experiences, 43% asking friends or family for their recommendation, 35% said they'll take the brand's ethical standards into consideration, and 19% said they would take the recommendation of a social media influencer. Now, as you would expect, when we segmented this by generation, it was overwhelmingly younger generations much more likely to look up reviews. So 64% of Gen Z compared to just 40% of baby boomers will look up a review to understand other people's experience. And I liken that to the days of almost like Airbnb where you're like, is this going to be good? I'm going to just read the reviews first. Like there's so much online reviews about anything these days that it's, again, it's what other people are saying rather than what the own brand is promising, because every brand's website is delivering you the world, but it's the power of recommendations. 58% of Gen Z are likely to ask their family or friends compared to 28% of baby boomers, so they don't need maybe as much validation from their friends and family. And then 36% of Gen Z, so over a third, are likely to take the recommendation of a social media influencer compared to 3% of baby boomers. So they're 12 times naturally, as likely. So of course you would go, there's not heaps of baby boomers who are maybe online watching Corporate Natalie or whoever these influencers are. But the younger generations are there. And it also reminds me of that study we did last year, which uncovered that 48% of Gen Z are turning to TikTok daily to teach themselves something new.
Yeah.
And so they are looking – it's almost like the new search engine is TikTok, and you're like, I'd love to watch a video about someone's experience of this. Now, the tension here is – people need to disclose whether it's an ad or not, because there is that like, well, how much do I trust this if this influencer is being paid to recommend this?
Yeah.
So people do need to disclose that, which makes it, I think, a bit easier for the consumer to go, I evaluate how much I trust this. Is this sponsored? Is this endorsed? Or is it just a genuine love of Michael Bublé's perfume from many, many years ago, you know? So
Yes. Exactly.
So yeah, interesting sort of, I think, a few different things there going on in terms of price, simplicity, and I think the power of recommendations. They're sort of the three things I kind of wanted to draw out from some of those studies we've done.
Yeah, no, fascinating. And it is interesting to kind of hear how these competing values, but that those different, you know, factors are being taken into consideration often, you know, together and in conjunction with one another, but how some of them, I guess in some circumstances may take priority, but it is, we've touched on this, I know, in previous podcast episodes as well, but even with younger generations having, or maybe even on in an online sense, putting a lot more emphasis on, you know, like social impacts or environmental impacts when it comes to the products that they're purchasing. And it's interesting how even before, one of our colleagues in the office just today had mentioned, oh, I found this $5 pair of sunnies, but it's on a website that is known for not being the most ethical in terms of production and, you know, the different practices that they have to actually create those products. And in my mind, it's just like alarm bells automatically going off where price has actually come or should be in my perspective in that moment lower than the other factors that should be taken into consideration there as well. But then sometimes price actually, it's just interesting how, I guess, depending on the context, some of those things can be, I guess maybe considered more than others. But even with what you were talking about in terms of recommending and receiving recommendations from friends or from online audiences as well, how much the platforms like TikTok, where all of a sudden it's not influencers who have voices, it's anyone that has a phone can have a voice. And it's fascinating because even last year, I think you had mentioned that stat we have, I think 46% of Gen Z,
yeah,
Z
40, go to 48, yeah.
48% of Gen Z go to TikTok daily to learn something new. I remember hearing that and was like, oh, that's not me. And then me every single night, new recipe on TikTok, new thing on TikTok. And even there's a purchase I made recently of a new pair of shoes, which I watched a bunch of people on TikTok, not influencers, not people that are paid, just everyday people talking about the product. And that was how I made the decision to purchase it. And it was a bit more of an investment as well. So it's just fascinating to think about how these recommendations are not necessarily coming from friends, not necessarily coming from the product's website itself with reviews that are left on there, but external platforms of just everyday people giving visual, you know, recommendations or advice based on their experience. So there's just a lot of information you can access out there. And I guess it's weeding between what you should take on board and taking everything with a grain of salt as well and making your own decisions. But in saying that, Ash, looking, I mean, even tying in here to the idea of younger generations and how we're engaging with consumer behaviors and that sort of thing, how can brands seek to engage these consumers of younger generations today?
Yeah, I think there's definitely a drive and a push for younger generations and the word authenticity, and that has been a bit of a buzzword over the last few years. But I think it is coming from a place where younger consumers are savvy and highly perceptive when it comes to spotting authenticity or inauthenticity. And so brands that do demonstrate transparency, that are open about their practices, I think are more likely to sort of earn that trust. And I think your point just then about kind of this tension between especially younger consumers who might not have as much purchasing power or who are trying to save in a tough economic environment for a home deposit or whatever it might be, they have this desire to shop ethically and to avoid fast fashion. But there is this reality of the economic sort of conditions. Yeah. And it's something that we're going to talk about a little bit in our Trends of 2025 research, which will come out in a few weeks/months, month or so, a few weeks,
yeah.
Which spoiler alert, is talking about the consumer compromise and how there is this desire for people to behave ethically with their finances. And we were talking about it internally when we were kind of discussing and formulating this trend, and how I don't think many people go, yay, I can't wait to buy from this like fast fashion company where I know there might not be very great practices behind how this product has been made, but the price point is so compelling that you do make that compromise. So yeah, that's kind of something we're thinking about and looking at and trying to explore, and the rise, and therefore the rise of the dupe, and you know, some of those other consumer trends that we're seeing among younger people. But I do think they value authenticity. The other aspect I think that's important, which we've talked about a little bit, is to leverage their preferred platforms, which are often digital. And it does mean engaging younger people by meeting them where they are. So TikTok, Instagram, emerging interactive spaces, maybe for Gen Alpha, that could be the metaverse type worlds like Roblox or Minecraft. And we've heard brands already starting to kind of try to get into those spaces to connect with younger consumers. So just offering kind of dynamic ways to connect and making sure that you're not just going one size fits all. If you do want to reach younger people, I think that's really key. And brands that do adopt that storytelling and video content are thriving at the moment with younger generations. So being able to showcase and display creativity while keeping sort of content bite-sized and visually engaging, I think, is really important for younger people.
Absolutely.
And the other thing I would say is, yes, price is important. Yes, people are looking at that bottom line, but they're also are valuing purpose and that alignment with the brands that they want to engage with. And so, yeah, I think younger generations do have that desire to align with brands that share their vision for a better, more equitable world. So we've seen some of that research in sort of the Baptist World Aid sort of ethical fashion guide that we've helped them with in the past. And I think I don't want people who are hearing this who are trying to go down the real ethical route and therefore where products have a higher price point to hear us saying younger generations are just compromising everything and they're only buying from fast fashion or whatever it might be. I think there is definitely a place for that purpose and values alignment and how you sort of share that message and your products and how you market your brand, your company and the products, I think is really important as we think about sort of engaging younger generations as consumers.
Yeah. Great insights there, Ash. I think there's a lot of, relevant pieces of insights there that are relatable across so many brands and industries looking to engage this younger generation of consumers, such as myself as Gen Z or Gen Alpha, like you mentioned, who might not have full purchasing power, but even as we've seen in research, are influencing their parents' purchasing decisions, and are having big impacts in that way. So what are kind of the ways that we can be looking preemptively in a lot of senses to be engaging them, and what methodologies are the best in doing that? So I guess as we just wrap up here, there might be a lot of listeners that represent different brands, different organizations, different sectors where these insights apply in their context. And what sort of research methodologies would you recommend to a brand who's looking to strategically understand their consumers?
I think research is so powerful in this regard. We have the pleasure and the privilege of working with a lot of different companies and industries across different sectors that are looking to not just kind of make big, expensive marketing decisions based on just their gut feel alone. And that's the power of research, that it can confirm or deny something. It gives evidence and facts to that gut feel. And so we love partnering with organizations who are curious about their consumers, who are interested in learning about the difference across the generations in terms of where they've heard about certain products, where they're going for trusted advice, all the different aspects we've talked about today in terms of their values and their payment methods and preferences. And so we can gather those insights and look at that. We love doing that through surveys particularly. And, that's where we get a lot of these stats, but also pairing that with focus groups and qualitative insights where you hear the stories and, you get people in a room and you get to sit behind a double-sided mirror and hear about what consumers are thinking. It is. It's like a big eavesdropping on a really strategic conversation. Yeah. So yeah, there's so many different ways that we can work with organizations. We can, run consumer or stakeholder studies and test, net promoter score or net repeater score. And that's the other thing. I've been talking to a few organizations lately about this, where net promoter score is basically when someone rates their experience with a brand, and if you, so it's like, how likely would you be to recommend this service or this product to someone? And if it's like a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being extremely likely, 0 being not at all likely. I'm really trying to remember my research days now. And so then 8 to 10 is promoter, I think. And so that score, and then I think like, oh my gosh, 6 to 7 is like passive. And then anyone above, a bit below 6 is a detractor. And so basically you take the average and you basically, you don't really count the passives because they're like the people who sit on the fence, but you're taking the proportion who would highly recommend it, and you minus the people who are like passive. So anyway, it's a bit of a formula. It's quite well recognized. I'm sure many brands, companies who are listening would listen to that. So we can test that. But the other thing we've been doing in more recent times is also net repeater score. So not even just would you recommend this product, but would you purchase it again? Or, you know, engage with this brand or company again. So it really does put you not in the hypothetical, but more in the practical. Like, and so, yeah, there's just different methodologies and different ways that we can test and get insights and hopefully give some evidence-based insights to organizations and brands and boards and leaders and heads of marketing or chief marketing officers, whoever they might be, to just have a bit more insight into what your customers are thinking, where things are going. So, yeah, that's the research methodologies. And like you said, Holly, we also love sharing these insights with lots of slides and humor and stories at events. And, yeah, I find that a lot of people ask us, what is the future consumer landscape or what is the future employee landscape? So we have so many insights, just a little small portion of what you and I have talked about today that we kind of get to share and tell the story about and in a really fun way to make data interesting and relatable for people. So, yeah, it's such a lovely, lovely, fun topic, I feel like, because it talks about people and we're all consumers in different settings, and so we can probably all relate to a lot of these insights.
Yeah, fantastic, Ash. And I love that overview there at the end, and just, you talked about it before, but how our passion at McCrindle is making data important for people, making people be able to see it and understand it in a way where it's relevant, where it helps you make strategic decisions, help make informed decisions about the future. And so whether, that might look like running a new piece of research with us or engaging our team, such as Ashley, who is one of our wonderful advisors, for a session on these topics, we would love to help. So you're more than welcome to get in touch via our website, and one of our team would be delighted to help you with that. But it was great to get just a taste of some of this future consumer content. Ash, there's so much more I know we could delve into, even just with each of these questions individually, but appreciate you condensing so much content that you speak on into just a mere 32 minutes together today. But I'm sure there's lots for listeners to be able to take away and implement in their own organizations and spaces. So thank you for all of your insights and your time today.
It was my absolute pleasure, Hol.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, we would recommend subscribing to McCrindle Plus for exclusive access to our latest reports, infographics, and masterclasses. And of course, you can always hit follow on the podcast or catch us on social media. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.